Hello and welcome everyone to another video in which I test some audio software, and this time I want to look at Emergence by Daniel Gergely or Gergely or Gergely or Gergely. I don't know. So one of these is probably right and the other three are wrong. But anyway, I like granular plugins, but I don't have a lot of granular plugins yet because sometimes they cost like 50 euro and I think like, do I really need to pay 50 euro for something that just fucks up some buffers for me? And the answer is obviously yes, because I can't make these sounds in my productions yet, and apparently it would really make sense to invest a little bit more in granular plugins. But since I'm still cautious about that, I'm very grateful for this developer to actually release a free plugin in that direction. So yeah, I have not tested it yet, so let's just jump right in. I have made a little the plugin in action without anything going on yet, and just to show you what it's doing already when you just load it up. But I prepared a little beat here. Let's turn it off again. Emergence, the name is Emergence, and I made a little beat which sounds like this. So, by the way, in this beat, I used Chokick, the plugin that I made a video about last time, because I found it very nice and I thought, yeah, I should just use it again. Since even though this video is not about Chokick, and turn out that it works really nice together with this bass that I made. Of course, there is some sidechaining on it and a little phaser. And on Chokick, since I always do that on kicks, I use a little bit of disperser to round down the low end, and it works pretty nice driving hard with dirt for Native Instruments. And of course, cutting off all the low end, because this disperser puts some low end into the really, really, really low frequencies, and some character shaping, blah, blah, blah. But yeah, this plugin really has a nice workflow. So this is just a follow-up statement to my last video, which was really long, but you should really test this, even though it's very peculiar and sometimes you can do specific stuff with it, but it has a really good workflow in general. So now, I have not tested this granular plugin yet, but I thought maybe it would make sense to just try it on the bells, maybe, because these bells are actually a sampled energy drink can that I just chopped really shortly, so that the identity does not get lost. But it's still pretty dissonant, since energy cans, when you hit them with something, they are they don't produce nice harmonics only. And yeah, I kind of got around that a little bit by applying some reverb and some phaser, by cutting away all the stuff that I don't like, and also dispersing the high end can make things very bubbly, which is quite nice, IMO. And but it's not enough yet. It does give it a little bit of distance, because if I did not do that, then it would be very upfront. And this gives me the opportunity to actually put it even far further away, I think. But anyway, let's just take this and render it in place to a new track. And pretend like this is our track. So now we have a rendered bell track. And we can try the plugin on that. Emergence. So we have an emergency. We want to save this plugin. Save this sound from getting, from sucking. Now let's just play back. And it already does something, which is a little bit surprising, because this whole interface with this thing that goes around here and has a freeze and clear knob kind of reminded me of Pollock Stretch, which is very similar, but it needs you to capture the input before it can do its magic, while this thing already does magic before anything else, and I think it does not even have a capture button, so apparently it's more real-time safe than Pollock Stretch. One thing already that I don't like about this plugin is that it stops doing its graphical thing when there was silence for a while. And I know why that is, because it is because process block, the method, if you are the developer and listening and you are wondering why this happens, then it's because process block sends buffers of size 0 in when there is silence for a while. So you probably have something in your code like if there is if only 0 samples are sent, then stop capturing the data from the project position. But I would like to encourage you to actually keep getting this data and only return afterwards, so that it's at least still moving when nothing's happening, which is giving me more like the idea that this is still working and didn't freeze. But this is like very critique on a high level, so let's rather check out the actual sound. So this seems to be a very important parameter, because it's like up here and kind of has this special place where nothing else is, and down there the tooltips tell me that this sets the maximum number of active grains. This can be useful to limit CPU load. So, okay, we see the number of grains here. So if we turn that up to 600, then it sounds like this. So yeah, it's, I don't know, it's, pretty much the same sound, but I guess that's also because I only have one stream enabled so far. So maybe let's just turn this down to something reasonable, like I don't know, 24 sounds nice. I just don't get there. Does this have sensitive mode? And of course it does. So very nice. On CTL, by the way. Now let's get started. With, yeah, I don't know, what should I even start with? What does the freeze button do? Freeze buffer contents, no input added and no feedback loss is applied. So there are delays in here, and there are feedback delays apparently. So clear the buffer. Mm-hmm. Okay, clearing the buffer. Yeah, I don't know what that did. Okay, it just immediately clears the whole buffer. I don't know yet for what that's good for. Probably when you have some build-up going on and then you freeze the thing and then you just put an automation on clear at the point where the whole beat is replaced with some cheesy statement before it goes to the drop. So randomize knob values. Use the button next to each knob to lock the value so it is not randomized. Oh, that's nice. Really nice. So apparently randomizing the whole thing is a huge feature in this plugin, so huge that the developer decided that there has to be some special functionality that is even more special than just randomizing stuff. I guess it could have some workflow like setting the first stream, then locking all these things, and then randomizing the second stream until it's cool, and then locking that, and so on, until you have all the streams ready. Yeah, but let's just check out the general delay parameters first. So it's not like a real delay or something, it is just something that copies it's content to itself, but with some weights or something like that. Balance, choose which input channel is used, left, right, both. I think I will use both. I will just generally use both. Buffer size, change the buffer size, clears the buffer when changed. So this is a non-automatable parameter, or one that should not be automated probably. Anyway. A word to the developer, you could easily make this automatable by just setting a maximum buffer size and only use the parts of it that are actually important. This has a maximum size of 5 seconds, so it could always be 5 seconds long, but then you would have the possibility to not clear the buffer every time the parameter has changed, but you could actually introduce some other cool effects like a pitch bending, sliding to the new value thing, which is always really cool. But in a granular context, you might even do something like fading in and out the last grains to the new grains instead, which is less analog and more like granular fun. But still pretty cool, I guess. It's just that you have to commit to some value and then it is just it. Yeah, just try to find the note that is like most prominent in this sample. I think I got it, maybe not, who cares. Volume dry. Let's turn down volume dry, we don't care about the dry signal. Oh yeah, much better. Now volume buffer, volume granulator. What's the difference? Oh. Okay, so the buffer is apparently this whole thing. But what's the granulator? Let's just listen to the granulator itself, and maybe it has something to do with the streams? Oh. Hä? Why did one of these things just die? That's where the fun is. So yeah, I just found out what this knob actually is good for. I always thought to myself, wow, why does it only sometimes play my streams and sometimes not when I solo them? And then I realized, oh yeah, I put down this number a lot. That makes sense. So I put this up and it immediately burned my CPU to death when I pulled it up to the max. But when I got a little bit back from it, and it actually got nice again. Thank you. Wow, that's so cool! I'm starting to get ideas with this. Super cool. I mean, it makes no sense in the context of this beat, obviously, because this is just a nice little beat, like a normal house beat, and then there's suddenly this granular monster in it, and it just makes no sense, but who cares? I'm a sound design fan, and I love exploring stuff like this, and maybe I just take this sample that I just rendered and use it for something else. Thank you. Okay, so back to the actual plugin. I know the people who watch this video don't want me to watch, don't want me to use other plugins so much. So what can I say about this? First I thought it was kind of weird. Then I thought it was, then it suddenly made click and I realized what the controls are for, which is cool because usually with granular plugins, I'm just so confused about everything. And usually I like it when I'm so confused about everything, but in this case, I like that I actually got some control back. Just a little explanation to everyone. Yeah, I mean the volume dry is just dry signal. Volume buffer is this little delay thing here. And granulator, which is some sort of delay line that also depends on this delay, but it is a little bit more special. And every stream of that has some controls. The most important one I know is the grain volume and the grain pan. And I think they should be together at either on the left or on the right. I don't like that the grain volume is somewhere in the middle because I keep having to watch for it. But anyway, that's not very important. As you can see, I'm very fascinated by everything. So this is just a detail. And yeah, anyway, one thing then that can also be explained easily is the grain pitch, which is just basic resampler. Sounds a little bit like a time domain resampler, which is just letting you pitch everything in that grain up or down by, I think, up to 2 octaves. Yeah, the tooltips also say in semitone. So yeah, that's pretty easy to use. So if you actually wanted to make something that it kind of depends on or relates to the stuff that you produced, then you could maybe more or less do that. But I don't know if I would use it like that, because experimentation is key and these kinds of plugins and some of the other controls also have their own properties on the pitch. So reverse probability is, you can always see how these grains are moving along this line. And sometimes they go into the reverse direction and sometimes they go into the forwards direction. And the reverse probability says how much it is probable that the thing goes backwards or not. So 0.5 in the middle would be like, it could either be this or that, and 0 would mean it goes, always goes forward, so you get more sharp transient thingies, and on 1 it always goes reverse, so you get a lot of these kind of stuff. Then the grain length is, yeah, it's always somewhere in the near this line. But the more you turn up the grain length, the more it can go away from it. So like on this stream down here, I chose a very low grain length so that it's always near the thing. And also moves very slowly, which I will come to very soon. And that's why it sometimes does, then it has a lot of silence until it comes back at some point, because the grain length just does not go so far and the speed is also very slow. In other examples, I have a very fast, on the blue one, I have a very fast moving line, but the grain length is also super fast, so it's definitely always all over the place, pretty similar with stream 1. So yeah, we have stream 3 and stream 4 doing the fragile, only sometimes being there stuff, and the stream 1 and stream 2 do the chaotic, all over the place kind of stuff. And then yeah, what did I not have covered yet? The increment is actually the playback speed of this line. So this line moves forwards or backwards depending on if increment is more on the left or on the right. So if it's like in the middle, then it's probably just not moving at all. I don't know if that's possible, but you can certainly put it on a very slow speed by using sensitive mode, as I said, with CTL. By the way, does it have sensitive mode for mouse wheel? No, it does not. That's sad. Should definitely add that. But if I recall correctly, then this is a Juice plugin? Because Juice plugins often forget to do that. Juice plugin developers, not sure actually. Is there any note about which framework was used? Anyway, it does seem a lot like a Juice plugin because of that. So please add mouse wheel support, as I said, say to literally everyone. Yeah, but apart from that, super cool. Interon set time controls how often new grains are started. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, because when you turn that down, then that's what I meant with some of the other parameters can also have an effect on the pitch, because when you turn it down a lot, then that creates its own pitch, because obviously the grains are so short that they are shorter than the actual grain itself, or the pitch that is currently kind of meant to be played. And then it sort of feels like it just overrides that pitch with its own pitch, but it's a little bit different. However, if you turn it down a lot, then you get this effect that you can really hear when a new grain is started. And so you get more of a rhythmic thing going on, which is why this thing ended up actually sounding rhythmic when I put on stream 2 the long intersect time. And it just created a whole new rhythm from this thing that had a very static, boring rhythm that was and now it's, what is this? Oh, oops. And now it's like, and I feel like, what the fuck, how did I do that? Anyway, I did it and it's cool. And yeah, that's the kind of stuff that I'm searching for when I think of granular plugins. I'm searching for the moments where I'm just like, what? I did not intend to do that, but that's better than what I intended to do. And or sometimes even like, I did not intend anything, but I just did something cool. So these are the two emotions that I want to have, and I have both of them, and that's cool. Now, can we even, like, is there a way to actually find critique for this? Yeah, I think maybe there is, because sometimes I would really like to put some modulators on some of these parameters, like the grain panning. For example, this stream down here is really slow. And I would really like it to actually show more of its slow being. Like on the graphical user interface, we can see that it moves from right to left, but the grain is always just on the right. So maybe it would be cool if the actual position on the line could also be used as a modulator, as a modulation source for any of these parameters. Now that I think of it, that could even be cool for multiple reasons. I mean, I could, of course, just then drag the position of this thing directly to the pan knob. But what if I drag it to some other streams knobs, so that the streams kind of relate to each other by their position in the sample? That would be kind of cool. Or some other modulators that you can come up with. I'm sure you're very creative about that, since you already made this. But you deliberately decided against adding any modulators, probably because this is just a little free plugin and it should be easy to use. And I think you also have in mind that most people use Ableton, where you can modulate things without modulators in the plugin. But you should keep in mind that some people have Cubase, like me, or some other DAW that just does not have this modulator stuff going on. Oh yeah, and before anyone comes and says, Cubase has modulators, you have just not seen them yet, then yes, I've seen them. I can show you how they look. Where is the LFO? MIDI modifiers, MIDI auto LFO. So the LFO in Cubase, the MIDI LFO, looks like this. And when you have to, first of all, it has no display on of the waveform itself or how it is running. It just has this, which looks pretty shit, then how do you assign it to anything? Yeah, well, you just select the control, but how do I know which control any of this is? I would have to look into the manual. And everyone who lives in 2021, actually already a lot of years ago, like 2002 or something, knows that manuals are shit and everything that looks like this is just a huge fail. So, fuck you, Steinberg. No, that's not professional. But, you know, it's also not professional to give users something that looks like this. I mean, what is your intention? Do you want to say, oh, we are the old door, we have to stick to our traditions or what? No, that's not cool. So I take it back. I didn't mean to say fuck you, but you could just be reasonable and then everything would be much better. Okay? So but I love you. I love you for making this software that I use since I'm a child. So that's definitely the opposite of fucking everyone or anyone. It's just that some things make me so angry. I'm a little bit jealous of all the people with the new DAWs that can slap modulators on everything, especially Bitwig. I don't know, but I think it's the sickest DAW of all time, but I'm just too lazy to learn a new DAW because I want to feel at home in Cubase and I want to feel very nice. And this whole interface gives me a nice feeling of being at home since it's kind of the thing that I learned the most since I'm a child, more than everything else. I'm sitting in a room right now. I'm sitting in the living room of the house of my girlfriend, which is going to be my wife. But even though this is my home, my actual home is this software. Okay, so this is my most homest home, and that's why I won't use a new DAW. It's just that some things are definitely bad for nowadays standards. So please don't feel insulted by the fact that I said that, by the fact that I said fuck you. But there are just things that should be fixed for sure, for 100% sure. And that's one of them. Because apparently, cool developers who do things like this just orientate themselves on Ableton and stuff. And they don't add modulators. So the DAW needs modulators, okay? Please give me modulators, okay? So that I can use these things much better. And until that's not the case, I just say to all the developers, please add modulators so I can use them. I love modulators. I want to use modulators. I don't want to use these modulators. I don't want to use the beautiful modulators in your plugins until my DAW has better modulators. But even without modulators, I could still use automation here, or just use the approach that I already did with rendering out stuff, and then maybe I could go ahead and select the parts that I like most. And that's probably what I would do most of the time anyway. So modulators are really not the most important feature in here, so I can understand the decision to just not add modulators to this plugin. It makes it easy, nice to look at, very understandable. Is this resizable? No, because I like how this interface almost covers the whole height of my screen. That makes it feel like I should spend a lot of time in this interface. And if there were modulators, then it would extend to some side and then it would cover the whole DAW just for this effect of immersion. So I'm not sure if I would still like that, maybe, but I think they really nailed the size of this thing with this bounce here. So yeah, that's not a lot to critique about that. Now that I actually rendered out a cool rhythm from this. Let's go crazy and actually randomize every little thing about this and see what happens, because I just know things will get so cool. Okay. All right. So we really have to lock some parameters, apparently. The input should always be 1. Feedback, I don't know. Balance should always be middle. Buffer size, no. Dry should be linked. And the granulator should always be normal volume. And now I think the other things can be randomized. Oh, interesting though, this parameter is not being randomized, probably because it is very crucial to always have this on a value that is not breaking the CPU. So the developer apparently decided that this is not part of the randomization. Spooky. Ooh, very interesting. Let's only look what the yellow stream is doing. That seems to be a really interesting behavior. It sort of pushes the first thing out and then a new one comes from the end sometimes. And how does it do that? So it has a playback speed, inter onset time. Oh yeah, that you can really see how that changes. Okay, okay, I get it. It is not really the case that there are always these things in this spacing, but it's actually changing so fast that the UI cannot show that any better than this. Like when a car drives by and you see the wheels and then it looks like they are going backwards because the frame rate of the eyes is not perfect, because nothing is perfect. And yeah, grain pitch, reverse probability, because it will change. Oh. Interesting. So actually when something is going reverse, then it also has tendency to be on the left of the line. It is not aligned to be always, the sequence of things is not always in the middle of the line. It's not like the medium thing to happen, but the reverse probability has an influence if something goes forward or backwards, but also if it's more in the on the right or the left. Grain length. Thank you. Awesome. It's just awesome. Fuck yeah. I think I will end this video like this.